In this tutorial, we are going to learn about types, variables, and values. Moving forward, we are going to be a little technical. So as before, if it becomes a little too daunting, always come back and review or leave us some questions. We will be launching our mentoring sessions soon, so you can bring your questions there as well. C# is a strongly typed language. What this means is that at compile time, the data is checked. If you declare an int variable of user age, and when you build your application, it's compiled to IL code. It's at this time that the C# compiler will check to make sure that you have used the variable correctly. If you try to add an int and a string, then you will get a compile time error and no application. The compiler will use your variables, methods, and other operation types to check that they are safe. In later topics, we will learn of a dynamic type, which will be checked at runtime when your application is executing, but that's for later. We will have created variables, and we stated that it's a storage area that we can use at a later time. Variables hold all kinds of data. Currently, you are familiar with int, bool, string, and decimal. In C#, we have many more, and as we learn and continue, we will use most of them, and we will create custom types as well. So a variable has a type. So does every expression that evaluates to a value. The same is true for every method previously. We call them commands when a method returns a value. Same with passing values into methods. They are called parameters as types. In our previous video, we mentioned libraries, and .NET has base class libraries with a set of built-in numeric types, as well as more complex types. As an example, the template C# program uses the console class, which is a class library and writing to the console hello world string, and string is a built-in type. The type of information stored in a type has the following properties. We will highlight two of them, but a type can have more. Minimum and maximum values of the type. Now, let's take a look at the characteristics of a numeric type. For example, int contains numeric values -2,147,483,648 to +2,147,483,648. If you add more, you get a compile time error, as you will exceed the space required in memory for an int value. Location of the type in memory. When you execute an application, the executable file on your disk is loaded into memory and your system will execute the application's instructions. In memory, the hosted application will have two locations that your application will store data: stack and heap. Types that are stored in the stack are bool, char, decimal, double, int, and other types that we haven't gotten over yet. The stack is very fast and contains the actual data. Types that are stored in heap are string and arrays, and as before, other types we have not gone over yet. The stack has a reference of the type to where it's located in the heap, a pointer, if you will. So what are the differences between types in stack and heap? Types that are stored in the stack are called value types, and types that are stored in the heap are called reference types. When you call a method and you pass a value type parameter or a reference type, the value type is passed as by value, meaning we make a copy of the value, and the reference type is passed by reference, meaning we pass the memory location of the reference type. Based on what we discussed earlier, it should be clear as to why that is. Value types are stored in the stack, and the stack has the value. The reference types are stored in the heap, but the stack has a reference to it and passes the reference to the location on the heap. Let's see if we can make this a bit more clear. Let's create a small application where the main method calls another method and passes two numbers and updates them. As the application executes, we will visualize how the stack is used. Notice that we have initialized our value types. And as we pass the values, we copy them. And when the method is finished executing, the value types are not affected by the change in the method. Now let's do the same with a reference type. This time, when we pass the reference type, we pass the memory location, and therefore, any updates will reflect the reference type. Now let's take a look side by side code and memory allocation as the application moves. So as the application is executed, we get a stack frame for the main method, which allocates three int variables on the stack and one string array. The first type string array is null because we don't have a location in memory for it and in the heap. But we will hold a place in the stack with no pointer. The next two ints are our values that will be passed into our method. When we call the method and pass our parameters, we create a new stack frame for the add method. Then we create three more int values in the stack, two for the parameters that are copied and one more for the returning value. As the add method exits execution, the add stack frame is removed. The value of the main method is the stack frame. The value in the main method in the stack frame is updated with the returning add method. As we move to call the second method, update my class method, the same process takes place and we can create a stack frame for the method. In the stack frame, there is only one parameter, my class, and as we updated its values, we are actually updating the heap. As the method finishes execution, it's removed from the stack, and now we can see that my class values that were updated in the update my class method persist. Hopefully, this made things clear. So stack, heap, value types, and reference types are all internal to .NET. As a developer, you will see it in the C# language. So what will you see? In C#, when you use a value type, the underlying object is a struct, and when you use a reference type, it's a class. Let's take a look at the string and notice that we have a class string. So, string class is just another representation of the keyword string. You can use either the string with a capital letter S or string with all lowercase. Generally, we have seen people use all the lowercase, the C# keyword, and we will be using them moving forward as well. Let's do the same for the int keyword. Notice that it's a struct, and the keyword int is represented as int32. As before, you can use int32 or int, but we will be using int. So now that we have looked at the string and int, does this mean you can create your own value type using struct and reference types using classes? The answer is yes. Let's just go over structs and discuss classes in a later video. So spoiler alert, we are just going to give you a brief view creating a custom struct, but in the third tutorial of this playlist, we will expand our understanding of classes, structs, and interfaces. So what if you wanted to pass the value types as a reference? In that case, you will learn of three new keywords, ref, out, and in. These keywords will allow you to pass any type as a reference. When we use the ref keyword, the parameter is passed and can be modified by the method. The value that is passed must be initialized. In the following example, we have a reference type and value types that are passed as a reference. Notice that if we execute the program, the variables in the main method are updated when calling the methods. The variables are also initialized. If we were to remove the initialization reference errors out, when we use the out keyword, the parameter passed must be modified by the method. Note that if we try to update the variable in the method, we get an error. We will provide a link in the comments section for full details of all value types defaults on Microsoft.NET documentation. But a few to note are bool is false, int is zero, decimal is zero. Now let's create our own struct types. We are going to use an application from our previous beginner's tutorial reading and writing files. We are going to read from our CSV file an uploaded structure into struct. So let's create a struct that can hold the following values. The year is going to be an int. Make is going to be a string. Model is going to be a string. Price is going to be a decimal. Please note that in order to use the struct, we need to initialize it with the keyword new. Now that we have our struct, let's load the CSV into an array of our struct. We know the number of lines that will be the length of our array, then we map our structure to the CSV values, then update our array with the struct. Next, we will update our application to use our struct array. You probably caught this. But let's clear it out. We used a string in our struct, so if our struct is created in the stack, what happens when it has a string type, which we stated is created on the heap? Our struct is created on the stack, but the string will have a pointer on the heap. Please note that the topic of this video was to help you understand variables and not methods. We used the methods to illustrate how passing and retrieving data works. We will go over methods in greater detail in later videos. So hopefully you're enjoying learning as much as we are teaching, and we thank you for your support. And in the next tutorial, we will learn all about strings.